From the American Riviera in Santa Barbara, California, it's Ken Boxer Live with your host, Ken Boxer, and co-host, two-time Olympian Ty Babilonia. Please welcome Ken and Ty.
Thank you. Thank you so very much.
Thank you
all for being here.
Yay.
And welcome. Welcome all of you. This is Ken Boxer Live. I'm your host, Ken Boxer, and my beautiful, talented co-host, Ty Babilonia.
Thank you. Hello. Thank you so much.
How was your week?
It was great. It's I never take a day off. It's like I run into the weekend, and it's just I have to keep it going, keep the work going.
You know, I was thinking when I was coming here today, I was thinking, you know, you were very successful early on in your career. Would you have preferred being successful later on? Oh, well, you're successful, I should say. would you rather have been successful later on in life as opposed to having this early childhood success?
That's a great question. That's a really great question. I think having it early on, Randy and I were 8 and 10 when we met, and the lessons we learned as children on the ice, off the ice, are lessons that I still use today in my life today and bringing up my son, Scout. So I'm glad that, some really wonderful stuff happened when we were children.
Well, who do we have on the show?
Oh my gosh, speaking of success at an early age, I'm so excited. I know, the multi-talented, he's an icon, correct?
Absolutely.
He's an icon. Actor, musician, writer, producer, Mr. Bill Mumy is here with us today. So stay right there after this message from our sponsors. We'll be back.
Ken Boxer Live, brought to you in part by DCH Lexus of Santa Barbara, providing Santa Barbarans and surrounding locations with prestigious luxury cars, SUVs, and hybrid vehicles. American Riviera Bank. Feel good about your bank. Real estate agents Julie Barnes and Jeff Oien, Village Properties Realtors. Now back to Ken Boxer Live.
Thank you. And welcome back. If you're just joining us, our guest tonight is the very talented, prolific actor, writer, singer, songwriter, and the one-time Emmy Grammy nominated Bill Mumy. What seems unbelievable to me is that Bill's been entertaining us for over 55 years with over 400 television shows, 18 motion pictures under his belt. His most notable roles, of course, the space explorer Will Robinson from the iconic television series Lost in Space, and his role as little Anthony Fremont from the television series The Twilight Zone. Bill's also a regular on the TV show Babylon 5. He's also an accomplished musician. Let's all welcome the multi-talented Bill Mumy to our show. Bill,
Amazing. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Ken. Nice to be here.
Thank you. Nice meeting you.
Nice to meet you, Ty. So you didn't start till you were 8? Slacker?
I know. What did you start?
What's up with that?
5 years old?
Yeah, five.
Yeah. It's amazing. And so much to show for that.
Bill, you had success early on.
Yeah, and but you got a bobblehead.
Yes, look, I've got a bobblehead.
I don't have a bobblehead.
Success early on. Later on in life, you're still very successful, you're very recognizable, but would you have preferred to have success later as opposed to early on?
No, not at all. My work as a child has enabled me to live a non-compromising artistic life as an adult. And I had a good time doing all the work that I did when I was a kid. It was really my own energy that led me into that field of acting. I broke my leg when I was about 3.5, 4 years old, and so I couldn't go out with my friends and play for a few months because I was in a big cast. I couldn't go skate either.
No, I don't think so.
But so I spent that time watching TV, and of course in those days, you know, couldn't rewind it. So I every day I was waiting to watch Superman and Zorro, caped adventurers, and they hit me in this really resonating way, and I bugged my mom and dad to get me inside the TV. And I was an only child, and we lived in West LA, and my mom and her family had been a part of show business before I was born. She'd been a secretary at 20th Century Fox, and my grandfather had been an agent in the 30s and 40s, best known for representing Boris Karloff. And so they weren't impressed with show business or intimidated with show business, and I really wanted to do it, so
you did can't you study? Escape your destiny. I mean, did you? Because watching your footage on YouTube, there's so much out there. It was like you were born to act. It's like, this is what you're supposed to be doing. It's so natural. Was there any acting training? You're welcome.
No, not really. I mean, after a certain amount of time, I would go over my scripts for Lost in Space with a lady just to get my cues together, because I was probably too rude to my mom to do it with her.
Right.
But I never really studied the craft.
Amazing.
But, you know, we're all given certain gifts, I think. And being able to memorize things and believe what I say when I'm
And you loved it, obviously.
I did.
And you love being at the studio. You love the whole
I did.
Atmosphere.
I had a really good time. I did. I had a good time, a real
was
good
it
time.
Easy for you to learn lines.
Yes.
You said you could memorize.
Yeah, but really easy. I could learn an entire script of Lost in Space. And Will Robinson, my character, usually had quite a lot to do on that show. And I could learn a whole script in an hour.
For the whole
the
show.
Whole show.
That's amazing.
And I would maintain it. You know, I'd pay attention to it for an hour and it would just be in the file. And I recently was working on a sci-fi pilot called Space Command. And it's still there. I can still learn a lot of lines really quick.
I got to show you something very quick.
Oh, yeah.
We have. You know, 50 some odd years ago, I was a fan.
Not quite. It's not quite 50 yet.
Not quite 50?
No.
Okay.
No, that was 1965.
Oh my gosh, that's great.
And you know, this picture, mm-hmm. I've had it stored in my parents' garage for all these years, and you were coming on. I had to pull it.
It's in mint condition, by the way. Take good
care
of that.
That's great.
Put that in Mylar.
Yeah, I love that.
No, that's very cool.
It is.
And it brings back nothing but good memories for me. I love those people, and I loved playing Will Robinson. Well, who wouldn't? He was a little superhero.
Right. Oh, my gosh.
400
great character.
Shows you've been involved with.
Mm-hmm.
400.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If somebody gave you the ability to be the head of a TV network, okay, with 400 shows under your belt, what would be the first thing you would change as a TV network executive? You're head of NBC. What would you change?
Well, honestly, I would have to look at what was on the boards for that network at the time, and I would have to honestly critique those shows. What we're missing on TV today is visionaries being given the right to produce their visions. Because if you look back to the golden age of TV, you have your Rod Serlings, and you have your Alfred Hitchcocks, mm-hmm. and you have your Walt Disneys, and you have your Desi Arnaz and Lucille Balls, et cetera, et cetera. But they produced the shows that they wanted to produce without a lot of network interference. There was censorship and sponsors. But basically, visionaries were able to give their work a fair shot. And in today's world, most every television show you'll see has probably conservatively a dozen producers attached to its credits. Well, each of those producers wants to justify their paycheck. So it's the old saying, you know, too many cooks spoil the stew or whatever.
Right. And they're not really creative. It's like no one, and I see this in my world, in the skating world, it's all about the quick fix. Mm-hmm. No one wants to take the time to create something and have, you know, a production. It's like, we call it cookie cutter.
Right.
Everything starts to, it's all starting to look the same.
Well, also, they don't really give anything much of a chance to find its groove anymore. If you look back at some very classic, well-respected shows, things like All in the Family, that's just one quick example. But that show didn't have an audience the first season, and it barely had an audience the second season. But the networks felt, well, you know, there's something here. Let's give it another 30 episodes see. In today's world, you get 4 or 6, regardless of how big your stars' names are.
That's true.
You know, they get a handful of shows at most, and if the numbers aren't there.
Well,
they...
you are a big star.
Oh.
You are a very big star.
I don't have a bobblehead.
But let me tell you, you're talking about great shows, The Twilight Zone, right? Everybody, The Twilight Zone? Yes. And you were involved, and we have a brief clip of a fantastic role that you played.
Right.
And I know you love that role, correct?
I do.
That's what I heard.
I do. It's one of the few roles or powerful characters that have continued to...
Anthony Fremont.
Anthony Fremont.
Let's watch the clip and then we'll talk a little bit about that.
It's a good clip. It's
all right,
a real
let's
good
watch.
Clip.
Monster, you. You dirty little monster.
You're a bad man. You're a very bad man. And you keep thinking bad thoughts about me.
Wish it into the cornfield. Please, son, wish it into the cornfield, please.
He was a bad man, so I turned him into a jack-in-the-box. A jack-in-the-box that still had his bad face. And you mustn't think bad thoughts about me either, or I'll do the same thing to you. Play some more music.
It's good what you've done to Dad. It's real good.
It was swell. It was just swell. It was really good.
Little Anthony Fremont, age 6, who lives in a village called Peaksville, in a place that used to be Ohio. And if by some strange chance you should run across him, you had best think only good thoughts. Anything less than that is handled at your own risk. Because if you do meet Anthony, you can be sure of one thing. You have entered the Twilight Zone.
Incredible. So what, watching that, what do you think?
After all these years.
Yeah, do you go back to a lot of takes?
No. It all went very smoothly, and it was a great learning experience for me, working with Cloris Leachman and John Larch and all those other great people. I can objectively see myself. I was 7.
Amazing.
It's a good show. Proud to be a part of that.
There's a sequel.
Yeah,
let's talk about that, because a lot of people don't know there's a sequel to that particular episode.
In 2003, when The Twilight Zone was revised for, I think it was the UPN network, the network wanted to do a sequel. It's called It's Still a Good Life, and Cloris Leachman and myself and my daughter, Liliana Mumy, got to do that together, and everybody was really, really nice, and I'm very proud of that.
Let me tell everybody that's watching that I saw the sequel, and you were just outstanding. The episode's outstanding. I'm not just saying this because you're here. I mean, that look that you had, you were able to nail it again. It's still very frightening to see you in that character.
Well, you get a get out of the cornfield free card for the day, Ken, so I won't be sending you away or turning you into anything nasty for a while.
That's funny.
But you, by the way, did you always get those jokes?
I do.
Are you okay with it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, because did one.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, the thing is, Anthony Fremont, or Will Robinson, for that matter,
right.
I mean, they're characters that I was extremely happy to get to play. I mean, who wouldn't want to be the most powerful mutant in the universe? Everybody, you know, he can read all of your thoughts. And if he was displeased with your thoughts, you're in big trouble, right? Yeah. So what a great, cool character. And he could manipulate matter in any way he wanted to. So, I mean, what little kid wouldn't like to be able to have that power? And, of course, Will Robinson, he had a laser gun. He got to use it. He flew the ship. He was programming the robot. He was saving everybody's butt week after week. He looked like a little superhero with his costumes.
That's
God,
true.
I loved that. That was the stuff that made me want to get inside the television, you know, when I was 3-4 years old.
It looked like you were having fun. I mean, I know it's hard work.
I had a lot of fun on Lost in Space. I mean,
right.
I don't know how much fun Anthony was having, but...
It was so natural, but...
What you have done, and it's. I was thinking about this earlier, because they're completely different arenas
right.
of... entertainment. Mm-hmm. But they both require great practice.
Yes.
They require memorization.
Absolutely.
They require trusting your partner.
Yep.
And most importantly, in the long run, when you're actually in a performance, they require not thinking about it, letting all that go.
Exactly.
And just being in that moment.
Just
and
being in the moment.
It's a very similar kind of thing.
But what was it like working with your daughter? You mentioned that just briefly.
Right.
Was that the first time you said you worked with her in that
Yes, we have done since then several animation shows together. She's a very prolific voiceover artist, and we've worked together on quite a few shows. But on camera, that was the first time we had worked together, and I couldn't have asked for a better partner.
Perfect.
You know, she was magnificent. She was legitimately giving me suggestions because I made her watch the old show because it's not like, you know, your kids want to sit at home, and I don't know about you. My kids don't want to sit around and watch Lost in Space or when they were
and
little.
And mine didn't want to skate.
Because,
you know what I mean?
Because
yeah.
You're in it?
Yeah.
Let's watch me, kids. No. Let's watch the Power Rangers or let's watch whatever they're into at the time. They, you know, but when we were doing The Twilight Zone, we sat down and we reviewed the original show together. And I did work on those looks when Anthony was using his powers. There was a little nostril flare, and of course the
eyes were
up. It's more a thought process, but there were physical little shticks to it. And so she having the powers as well in that sequel, I wanted her to use the same kind of gestures and stuff. But she was great. She was a big help. And when we were rehearsing, we filmed that up in Vancouver. And I can see us in this hotel suite rehearsing stuff, and she'd stop me. And she was all of eight, I think. And she would stop me and say, well, what if you tried it this way?
Oh,
honest
I love
to God.
That.
Honest to God. And she'd give me a line reading, and I'd go, that's a great choice. She had done the Cheaper by the Dozen films before that. And then after that, she did the Santa Claus films for Disney with Tim Allen and stuff, and a lot of other projects.
We mentioned in the outset that you're very talented also as a musician. How many instruments do you play?
Guitar is my main instrument, and there are even episodes of Lost in Space where Will Robinson was playing his guitar on some bad foam rubber rock. But I play guitar, I play keyboards, I play bass, I play banjo, I play harmonica, I play mandolin, I play drums.
And you're very modest because you play them very well.
Yes.
I'm comfortable saying, you know, I'm a guitar player.
Let's show this new CD that you've got.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, tell us about it.
It's called Illuminations. It's on the GRA label. It's available wherever CDs are available. And, you know, it's all original music. And there are 7 videos from that album that we've made. And I'm proud of that album.
Okay. Is it a release, the music? Is it your outlet?
It's what I do.
Okay.
I couldn't if I released it or if I didn't release it, I would be doing it.
Still,
okay.
Yeah.
Let's watch this clip that you brought with you of this song.
Okay.
It's titled.
It's called Sure of Nothing.
Sure of Nothing. Great title. Let's watch. Bill Mumy. Mumy as our guest. And Bill, I was doing my research and we found that you have a video that was ranked among Rolling Stone magazine, ladies and gentlemen, if you can believe this, Rolling Stone magazine named one of your music videos, I think it was number 57 out of 100,
yep,
as the best video, music video of all time.
That would be Fish Heads.
Fish Heads.
Anyone ever heard of Fish Heads? Yeah. Them up, yum.
You were
not a pretty story, but one that had to be told.
But you were a group Barnes and Barnes.
Barnes and Barnes. My partner Robert Hamer and I. Yeah, we've over the last 30 years released 8 or 9 albums, and Fish Heads was definitely the shining jewel in our show business tiara, so to speak.
And people can see that on YouTube because I watch it.
Yeah,
you can
Fish Heads has been Fish very Heads. Good to us, and it's easy to find.
You know, but Ty wants to ask you something about you work with so many different people.
Well, I Googled, and it's like I have to ask him about working with Alfred Hitchcock.
Mm.
Was that?
I did 3 shows for Alfred Hitchcock, 3 of his Alfred Hitchcock Presents, one that he directed that won a bunch of awards, and it was a very powerful television show. Mm-hmm. I didn't really like Alfred Hitchcock. I'll tell you my Alfred Hitchcock story real quick. So in a nutshell.
It's a great story. I've heard this.
This episode is called Bang You're Dead, and it's the story of this kid, and I was 7.
Right.
Whose uncle comes back from a trip and says he has a present for him, and all his friends are outside playing cops and robbers and cowboys and Indians. So the kid is impatient. He goes through his uncle's suitcase, finds a revolver and a box of shells, a real revolver and a real box of shells. Says, "Oh, this is my present."
Ah.
Takes the gun, puts a bullet or two in the chamber, spins the chamber, puts a handful of bullets in his pocket, and goes out to play with his friends.
Right.
So as the show progresses, he slowly goes from having a bullet or two to having all 6 chambers filled with live ammunition, spinning it around, and you never know when it's gonna go off cause some major destruction. So I was basically in every shot of this episode. And of course there are child labor laws, and you can only work X amount of hours a day. So the welfare worker had told the first assistant director, "Oh, you're going to lose Billy in 10 minutes. Oh, well, we want to get this one more close-up in before we wrap him out for the day.
Right.
So we'll have him stand in for himself while we light this last thing," which was fine with me. But let's remember, I'd been working there for 8 or 9 hours all day. I'm 7 years old, I'm not a stand-in.
Right.
So while they're lighting me, I'm fiddling around.
I'm seven.
I've been working all week for him in every shot, turning in what I think holds up as a fine performance. And so I'm straying a little bit while they're trying to light me. So Alfred Hitchcock gets up out of his chair. Now, first of all,
Is he tall?
No, but he was large. He looked like Jabba the Hutt.
Okay, got it.
He always wore the black suit. He always had a tight white collar with a black tie, jowls hanging all over it, and he was always sweating, a very imposing physical presence.
So he comes up to you and?
He comes up to me and he bends down to me and he whispers in my ear, and I swear to you on my children, this is exactly what he says to me, that no one can hear but me.
"If you don't stop moving about, I'm going to get a nail. And I'm going to nail your feet to your mark. And the blood will come pouring out like milk. So stop moving." Right?
And you're 7.
And I'm like,
"Oh my God."
"Huh?" I'm like, "What?" "Okay." And I'm like, "Okay." And they get their shot. And then they wrap me out for the day. And I'm walking out of the stage with my mother to her pink 59 Cadillac. And I'm saying to my mother, "And he seems going to nail my feet to the floor in blood and milk." And my mother, "Oh, honey, he's British. They have a different sense of humor."
Oh, my gosh.
Okay,
perfect.
Now, wait a second. Well,
that's
a great story.
But, that's a great story.
But the question,
very true.
But the question is now, though.
Yeah.
Take it a generation to your daughter now comes to you with that same event. Uh-huh. What would you say to your daughter? Would you allow your daughter to go back on the set?
I think we'd each have a house on the beach because I would have sued the schmuck.
Oh, my God.
You would
God.
Have. Absolutely. Today you would have.
Here's the thing, and I mean this seriously.
Interesting.
If he had said to me when he got the shot, "Thank you, Billy. I was just teasing, you know," I wouldn't even remember it today.
Right.
Right. It would have gone poof.
He said nothing.
No, but he absolutely, you could tell, he enjoyed the fact that he scared the heck out of me. A little 7-year-old kid who was working really hard for him. So if he had just said, I'm teasing you, it would have been fine and la-di-da. Yeah. But because he didn't, and I continued to work at Universal quite often until, you know, he was no longer alive. And every time I walked past his office, which was right next to Edith Head's office on the main drive of Universal, mm-hmm. towards the end of that main drive, I would go all the way around it. Because I never wanted to see him again. I never wanted to talk to him again. But you did work for him again. I think I might have done an episode after that one for him. I don't think Bang Your Dead was the first one.
Were you reticent? You really didn't want to do it?
No, because he wasn't directing it. I didn't audition. Wow. I didn't have to see him, and it was a different thing. And it wasn't that big a deal to me at the time. I wouldn't have said to my mom, I won't do that if I have to work with him again. I wouldn't have said that. But that story resonates within me because he didn't let it go. You could see he dug scaring me. And we all know from reading his books about the man that he had great disdain for actors. He didn't like actors. Right. I don't particularly like Alfred Hitchcock.
We just got less than a minute, if you can believe this.
But
we'll have to do this again sometime.
There's so much to talk about. Your stay in Santa Barbara. You've been here before. You love Santa Barbara?
I love coming here. I would love to to live in this zip code with my wife and our many dogs. It's a beautiful place to be, and I'm very happy to be here. Thank you for bringing me up.
No, thank you for coming. Yeah. Appreciate it so very much.
Such great stories,
thank
Bill.
Thank you. Well, we have a lot of friends in common.
We do.
We do. We're finding this out.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so much more to talk about even after the show, right?
Sure. Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
That's it for another edition of Ken Boxer Live. Now, we'd like to thank you for watching, and of course, be sure to tune in to our next show, as we have legendary breakdancer, choreographer, Shabadoo joining us. Well, that's it for now. So for my guest, Bill Mumy, and for my co-host, Ty Babilonia, and for my director, George Montalvo, and for my entire production crew, I'm Ken Boxer saying that Ty and I will be seeing you next time on Ken Boxer Live. Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Ken Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. DCH Lexus of Santa Barbara, providing Santa Barbarans and surrounding locations with prestigious luxury cars, SUVs, and hybrid vehicles. Palazzio Restaurant, where people don't leave hungry or thirsty. Real estate agents Julie Barnes and Jeff Oien, Village Properties Realtors. American Riviera Bank, feel good about your bank. Wendy Foster, Santa Barbara and Montecito's premier clothing store. Harbor View Inn, welcome to Santa Barbara's premier 4-diamond luxury boutique oceanfront hotel. Via Rosa Inn, let us pamper you in international style. And by Taffy's Pizza, delivery, pickup, or dine-in. Los Arroyos Mexican Restaurant, takeout. Perfect Computers, your local computer expert since 1990. Local sales, service, superior support 24/7. Rubicon Theater Company, not your typical season, not your typical theater company. Summer Lee, makeup artist, stylist, and aesthetician.